It's the Yule Kids Club! Except the holly in the Yule Kids Club! A full of jolly, just in the dentist! And Amy likes elves in the Yule Kids Club! Yule Kids Club!
Hey everyone, and welcome back to the Cool Kids Club. This is episode 44, and I am one of your hosts, one of America's favorite siblings, and my name is Amy.
Yeah, and I'm Justin, and I hate to start out the podcast with a correction, but I feel like I have to get it out there.
Uh-oh.
I believe we're the Yule Kids Club currently.
Oh, shit, we are.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because it is December.
You want me to go back and do it again?
No, I don't. Or, no.
Oh, okay.
We'll just move.
We're Yule Kids.
We're Yule Kids Club.
We're just going to move past it.
Just move past it. How does anything happen?
Just move past it. Guys, it is Yuletide.
The Christmas season is here. Are you?
It is.
Are you feeling it? Have you done any decorating? Have you watched anything besides what we're talking about in this episode?
I have. Yes, and I have. Right now, I'm looking at my Christmas tree, which is up but does not have ornaments on it yet. But it is lit.
Okay.
So we got that going for us. I actually was going to go out tonight and get some extra lights that we needed, but I'm recording this podcast instead. So
yeah.
I'll do that tomorrow. And I have watched, aside from the movie we're talking about today, which I did watch the other day, I have watched Christmas Vacation. So that's it so far of the Christmassy movies. What about yourself? What about you?
The tree is up. There's a couple other decorations.
And it's beautiful.
Up. Thank you very much.
I think we should post pictures of our trees on Instagram, like on the Cool Kids Club.
Sure.
So once I get my tree up and decorated, we should post pictures.
Cool Kids Clubhouse, as I like to call it.
Yes.
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 Yeah, and we've got a few other decorations up, but there's more to put up still. But the tree's the big thing, and that's up. Yeah, and as far as stuff I have watched, well, obviously... if you're unaware, we're talking about Muppet Christmas Carol movie kids or Cool
Muppet.
Kids movie club is back.
Kermit. See, I did it good that time. Kermit.
So obviously, I watched that to prepare for the show, and then I also watched Elf. That's the only.
That's right. The only other Christmas. April was telling me you guys watched that.
Elf has become kind of my movie to put on when I'm putting up the Christmas tree.
Yeah, that's a good one.
Although this year we were able to get Elf and most of Muppet Christmas Carol watched while we put the tree up.
While you put the tree up, wow, okay.
Well, we got all new ornaments and we had to put the hooks on them manually.
Yeah,
so it took
a while.
Than normal.
Yeah, I feel you. So you are full. We are fully in the holiday spirit.
We're the Yule Kids Club.
We are.
Holly and
was
Jolly.
Your Thanksgiving. I mean,
You were there. It was fine.
I was there. It was fine. It was uneventful in that we did not try to burn your house down like we did a few years ago. And every subsequent Thanksgiving without a fire is a big check mark.
Yeah. That's the bar you set for yourself is don't burn anything down.
Yeah. Yeah. Yep. Yep. So we're in the holiday spirit. We're past Thanksgiving now. We had 5 days off work. It was glorious. Mm-hmm. And it was not enough. It was not enough.
It's been tough going back this week, I'll be honest.
Yeah. We are very lucky because we both work in higher education. So we get like about 2.5 weeks off at Christmas.
Not that much.
We get 2 full weeks, I think, don't we?
That's like 12 days or something.
Okay. Well, we get more time probably than the average person.
Yes.
And I am just very ready for
everyone's,
that.
Everyone's ready for it. The mood on campus is over it. Done.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. We're all phoning it in for the next few weeks.
Yeah, I got one more thing left to do for a class I'm taking. And it's like pulling teeth trying to get me to do it. I want one thing I have to do, and I just keep putting it off.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
But we're not here to talk about school. We're here to talk about Christmas, and more specifically...
Yeah.
We're here to talk about one of our favorite Christmas movies of all time. So, we did a movie club last year in December.
Uh-huh.
And we did Santa Claus, with Tim Allen.
Oh, man, yeah.
So what do you what was, I mean, there's, God knows, there's a bajillion Christmas movies.
Yes.
So of all the Christmas movies we could have picked to do on this, on the show, what made Muppet Christmas Carol kind of stand out and be like, yeah, that's the next one we're doing for our Christmas movie?
You know, it's weird because neither of us watched this movie when we were little.
No, not really.
I mean, we probably saw it, yes, but didn't really remember much about it. It wasn't like a tradition, which is strange because we loved the Muppets and we used to watch the Muppet Show all the time.
Yes.
So it's not as though we were a anti-Muppet family in any way. So it's strange that this was not a childhood classic for us as it was lots of other people. So we have started watching it every single year for the last several years now as adults. And so I think it's fun because it's like a nostalgia. I mean, it came out in what year?
92.
So like, we don't have nostalgia for it, but it's nostalgic because it's the Muppets from 1992.
Well, you know, it's kind of weird because, you know, we did grow up on the Muppets. We watched the Muppet Show a lot and we watched Muppet Babies a lot.
Oh,
and,
yeah.
Of course, Sesame Street. And I remember watching Fraggle Rock and all of that going back.
Yeah, we were no stranger to Jim Henson
in any way. But I never saw any of the Muppet movies until I was an adult. None of them. Most of them, not until this year,
actually. Do you remember? Yeah, I was about to say, Justin and I embarked on something this year called Muppet May, because we had only ever seen five big Muppet movies or six. We had only ever seen Muppet Christmas Carol. So we decided to go in order, skipping the Christmas one, because we'd seen it and it was May. And Justin did it and made it all the way through.
I didn't make it all the way through.
Oh, I thought you did.
I didn't watch Muppets in Space, and I didn't watch the newest one. The Muppets Most Wanted, I think, is what it's called.
Oh, right. Oh, okay. Oh, I wasn't even considering those, frankly, in my Muppet May. I was just going to try to get the OG ones. But I have seen the two new ones, and I hadn't seen the other ones.
Okay.
But I did not make it. I only got the original and Muppets Take Manhattan watched, because then I got so busy with work that I didn't have time.
Well, the Great Muppet Caper is an all-timer.
Oh, wait, that's the one, right? That's the second one.
The Great Muppet Caper is the one with Charles Grodin in it.
Yes, that's the second one I watched. Which one did I say? Oh, Muppets Take Manhattan. That's the third one. I did not get that one, yeah. So it was the original and the Great Caper. Those are the two that I watched this year.
So this is the first one that was produced by Disney, and this is also the first one that was developed entirely after Jim Henson's death. So Jim Henson died.
Oh, okay, okay.
He died in May of 1990. And I know. I'm still heartbroken about it.
Oh, Big Bird singing at his funeral.
Oh my God.
Yeah, if anybody wants to just...
If you want to weep uncontrollably.
Yeah. Like, if you just need a good cry, just Google Jim Henson's funeral where Big Bird sings and just... Oof.
It's cathartic. It's cathartic.
It is.
Yeah, so the development of this really didn't go any further than, you know, they had an idea to do an adaptation of A Christmas Carol. They thought it would make a really good Muppet movie, and it was originally going to be...
Spoiler alert, it's great.
So Brian Henson, who is Jim Henson's son, ends up directing it, and they get Jerry Jewell, who is a longtime Muppets writer. And he comes up with the idea of having Charles Dickens as a character in the movie. As sort of the narrator.
Okay. Yeah, the narrator.
Yeah, because they were trying to be, you know, it's funny to say it's faithful, but it is a pretty faithful
adaptation.
Yeah, so he had the idea.
The only large difference is puppets.
No, they're Muppets. No. Can I just say that I cannot believe we've gotten this far in the podcast and we've never done an episode about any Muppets at all.
I know.
Any Muppet thing.
We've had three Garfields and somehow we're on episode 44 and it's our first Muppet.
I know.
Well, it's because it was a toss up between Muppet Babies and Tiny Toons, remember? And we ended up doing Tiny Toons.
We did Tiny Toons because we knew we were doing Muppet Christmas Carol.
Yeah, that's exactly right. But, yeah, I mean, I dare say look for Muppet Babies coming 2023.
Dare say.
I dare say, I do declare. I could see that happening.
Oh, for sure. Oh,
I'm just already, that song is already in my head. Anyway.
Do you want to sing it for us?
And
well, you can't, I mean, you can't tease us. We could do a little sidebar with the Amy singing the doo-wop Muppet Babies theme.
All right. You going to help me?
You get going.
You going to hop in?
You get going. I don't know.
Let me bring the lyrics up so I don't mess it up. Okay. Genius lyrics. Here we go. Muppet babies, we make our dreams come true.
Ooh-ba-doo-ba-doo-ba-doo.
Muppet babies, we'll do the same for you.
Ooh-ba-doo-ba-doo-ba-doo.
When your room looks kind of weird and you wish that you weren't there, just close your eyes and make believe and you can be anywhere. Muppet. Okay, that's pretty good. That was good.
Yeah.
Thanks. Even did some. Oh, and then at the end they go, Muppet, 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 Muppet Yeah, guys, like it's
an old doo-wop group.
It's a fucking bop.
You would fit in well in a like barbershop quartet there.
Listen, it's a fucking banger. They're always singing on this. We're always singing on this podcast. That's why we're America's Favorite Siblings.
Yeah,
it's the musical numbers. And there's going to be more in this episode because as we will get into, this is a musical. This movie is.
Like all Muppet movies, except I think for Muppets in Space.
That must be why it's the less adored, because there's no music. Yeah.
Yeah, but all other Muppet things are music, or all other Muppet movies are musicals. Because I mean, you gotta have music with the Muppets. It's such a huge part that's such a huge part of Muppet lore. You can't do the Muppets without songs. Yeah.
They are a very musical people, the Muppets.
They are. They are. Appreciate their musical culture.
You were telling me a little bit about how this came to be. This was supposed to be a TV movie first.
It was supposed to be a TV movie. They got, you know, Brian Henson, obviously. Jim Henson Productions still very much...
Sure.
You know, has control over the... I don't know about how much... These days, I know they're working with, I think, HBO or whoever.
So we don't, you know... We don't need to go into necessarily the story of A Christmas Carol. I think we all pretty much know the story. But we did have... There were a lot of people in the running to be the main character of Ebenezer Scrooge. Right.
So you know, like a lot of other Muppet things, you're going to have a couple of human characters, and
yeah,
it's just the thing that makes Muppets so great and so funny is how everyone plays it pretty straight. Like all the human characters, like they're not alarmed that animals are talking, or like this is like. You know.
Yeah. This is normal.
Yes. And no... And
like, Charles Grodin's gonna fall in love with Miss Piggy. Obviously. You know what I mean? Yeah. Like...
I mean, very, very clearly. Yeah.
There's no weirdness about that.
So, obviously, the main character of Christmas Story is Ebenezer Scrooge, and that's gotta be the most important character, right? So, who are we gonna get to play Ebenezer Scrooge? Well, they had several English actors lined up, you know. The type you can imagine who
Classic.
Would look sure. good playing Ebenezer Scrooge. Also, George Carlin was apparently in the running to play Ebenezer Scrooge in, and honestly, Oh my! I want to see that it so bad. Despite
George Carlin might be one of my favorite people that's ever existed that I've never met. and as much as I love Michael Caine as Ebenezer, mm-hmm. And just in everything, boy, would I have liked to have seen a George Carlin Muppet Christmas. Jesus, that's like all my favorite things.
I know, right?
Literature, Muppets, George Carlin. It's all my favorite things.
But unfortunately, it was not to be. But we get the wonderful Michael Caine, who is... God, he is just bringing it, man. He is now, this movie.
I feel like I've heard this, and maybe this is just... Maybe this is Muppet lore. But I feel like I've heard that his thing with this movie was he was going to... I mean, all the human actors play it straight with the Muppets, but he was going to play it like this was a dramatic movie.
Yes, there's like lots of, in the Muppets, there's a lot of, everyone's playing it straight, but there's a lot of winking and
Sure, like nods and more comedic. He is not here for the comedy.
So
he is.
I have a quote here, and this is from
the
mouth of Michael Caine himself.
Oh, God.
I'm going to play this movie like I'm working with the Royal Shakespeare Company. I will never wink. I will never do anything Muppety. I'm going to play Scrooge as if it is an utterly dramatic role and there's no puppets around me. That's what Michael Caine said.
That was actually a clip, you guys, of him saying
That was from my interview with Michael Caine. Which we will have
inside the actor's studio with him.
Inside the cool kid's studio. If we ever get famous enough to like get like celebrities or at least people from things we used to love when we were a kid on the show, we should call it that.
Oh man, yeah, 100%.
So yeah. Anyway, Michael Caine is bringing it to this role. He is playing it.
He really is
100% straight. Yeah. And it really does make it.
He is basically like, this is a... It does. And obviously, like, the character of Scrooge, of course, goes through, like, a transformation and, learns his lessons and everything. So, like, by the end, he is, like, happy and jolly. But it's still not... He's not being Muppety.
No, he's being Ebenezer Scrooge, because that's how Ebenezer Scrooge is at the end of the movie.
Like you said, he's like, I'm going to play it like... I would in any adaptation of A Christmas Carol.
Yes, like this is a traditional adaptation.
The fact that there are Muppets here. Yeah. And I do. I think that's what makes it, because that dichotomy is just so fun of like the Muppets, but then also you're like, this is a very heartwarming, touching portrayal of A Christmas Carol.
Oh, it really is. Best, he's so good.
One of the great British actors.
Yeah.
It's great. So you don't have that many human characters. You obviously have him. You have his nephew Fred and his wife Clara, mm-hmm. Played by Stephen McIntosh and Robin Weaver, and then
respectively.
You of course have Scrooge. Respectively. Yes. And then of course you have Scrooge's former fiance or former love, Belle, who is played by Meredith Braun. So those are like really your only human actors. I mean, other than like the extras, that's it.
Most of the extras are Muppets.
Are there no humans? Are all the extras Muppets? I'm trying to remember.
The sets, I don't know if you've ever seen how they, like, because I mean, honestly, I get so immersed when watching Muppet things that like it doesn't occur to like it honestly is done. The puppetry is done so well and it's filmed so well,
right,
that I don't think about like the logistics that must have went behind getting these shots. And if you've
seen, not at all,
like a behind the scenes like of how they do some of this, it's just insane, like building these towns. And like a lot of times, like Michael Caine is walking on like a narrow little platform, like across like an open space with people below him.
Because this is not made for a bunch of humans. It's made for Muppets.
Well, yeah. I mean, when 95% of your cast is puppets. Yeah.
Muppets, Justin.
Muppets. Jesus Christ. I admonished you for that earlier.
I mean, a Muppet is a type of puppet.
It's true.
So, you're not incorrect, but it's a specific... specific type of puppet.
So before we get into the Muppet characters, I want to
yes
to get into. Okay, so the film was released. So it was originally supposed to be a TV movie. After they got the script approved, they submitted the final script for approval, and Disney was like, actually, we'll buy this and we'll release it theatrically because this is really good.
Wow.
So it was released on December 11th, 1992. And like I said earlier, it was the fourth Muppets theatrical movie. And it was the first.
That's true.
The first to be produced by Disney. And Disney now owns Muppets, I believe.
They sure do. So. And ABC.
Yes.
They now own all of it.
Yes.
They own most things. They own most things.
Most things.
Most things. Yeah. Yeah. And I think that, I mean, they didn't gross a ton with this movie. Like, it wasn't as big of a hit, right, as they wanted. Well, moderate.
We'll talk about that later. Good. But, yeah, I mean, it was modest, but there were other big movies coming out right at this time that it kind of overshadowed it. But let's get back to talking about the characters, because
let's talk about these Muppets.
Tell me about these Muppets, Amy, because we've already said we have basically like four humans who appear with any sort of regularity in the movie.
Right. But then you've got
tell us about Charles Dickens. Just go ahead and tell us about Charles Dickens. So Charles Dickens, it was the decision was made that Charles Dickens was going to be a character in the movie, and he was going to narrate the story, and this was an attempt to stay as loyal to the source material as they could.
Right. So you have Gonzo the Great, of course, playing Charles Dickens. And now, you know what Muppets does really well is like banter and duos. So you can't just have Gonzo.
Rapport.
You could. Rapport, if you will. Mapor. Oh.
Mapor.
Anyway.
Rapid Mapor.
Just coining terms, you know.
Making shit
left
up.
And right. Just throwing shit at the wall and seeing what sticks.
Is Gonzo the best Muppet? Because I feel like Gonzo is probably my favorite Muppet.
You think Gonzo is your favorite?
I think Gonzo's probably my favorite.
Gonzo frustrates me sometimes.
Tell me about it, Amy. Tell me about your Gonzo frustration.
Now, not in this movie. I will say, not in this movie. I don't know. He annoys me a bit. Gonzo can annoy me, but not in this movie.
That's most Muppets, though.
No.
Not Kermit.
No, not Kermit. Kermit's perfect. Animal, he's too much for me. He needs medication. He's too much. He used to bring it down a few notches. But there's just something. Gonzo's fine. He's a good Muppet. Is he great? I don't know about that, but
yes,
he is good.
I do know he's great.
More importantly than Gonzo, Justin, is Rizzo.
And because we're trying to stay loyal to the source material, Rizzo the Rat is just playing Rizzo the Rat. Like,
Yes. And he's also kind of like playing this sort of like Greek chorus kind of character, you know.
He's commenting on the events of unfolding to the audience.
Yes. He is the best character in this movie. There's absolutely no doubt about that.
I don't know if I could argue that.
I don't think you can.
I think he gets the most laughs. He's the funniest.
He is. Should we do a poll on Instagram when this episode comes out of best Muppet in this movie?
Sure, we can definitely.
I think we should. Best human character. There's just the four.
Well, we never.
Just kidding. We'll do a best Muppet though for sure. Yeah, you've got Gonzo and Rizzo who are kind of popping in, and sort of you got like this framing story, which is them, you know, just sort of like narrating the whole thing and coming in and doing their little antics and moving us along in the story.
And it's some of my favorite things in the movie, honestly.
It's so great. Love the Mapor. Is it God bless my tiny broken body or whatever he says when he throws himself off the.
God save my tiny broken body.
God save my tiny broken body. And then They get down to the bottom and Gonzo's like, you could have just fit through there. And he could have just, oh God, it's too good.
I feel like when I watch these with April, like, April might enjoy them, but there's not a lot of like laugh out loud moments.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I mean, I guess not. I don't seem to notice them a lot because I do notice them, and most of the time, when you do get a laugh out loud moment from her in one of these movies, it's the mice.
Yeah,
it's Rizzo and the mice.
Yeah,
They're always so good.
They're so good. That is a particularly hysterical bit, though. The "God save my tiny broken body" is just
yes.
It's a great line. So that's who you see the most of, I would say. But you also then see the most of Kermit, who is playing Bob Cratchit, of course. So, employee to Ebenezer, and he is
probably the second most important character, I guess, in the story besides Scrooge.
Sure. Himself. Yeah. Yeah.
He's the guy. He's the guy we're supposed to sympathize with. He's
yes.
He's your everyman, or your every frog.
I was gonna say he's your everyman.
He's your every frog.
Yes, he is your every frog.
And I feel like Kermit always serves that purpose in all Muppet things.
Yes, I agree. Kermit is the straight guy. The straight man. 100%
straight frog.
Much to Miss Piggy's delight, I'm sure, they are married in this movie. She plays his wife, Emily, and then their children are just tiny versions of them. So, like, Tiny Tim is just a tiny version of Kermit.
Well, Tiny Tim is Robin the Frog.
What now?
Robin the Frog.
Who's Robin the Frog?
That's Tiny Tim in this movie, and it's Kermit and Miss Piggy's child.
Oh, in Muppet lore? I don't think I knew this.
Yes, in fact, I'm gonna crack another egg of trivia over your
head
right
now. Let's go ahead
and
do that, yeah.
Robin the Frog was originally, so when they were kind of putting this movie together, they were like, well, the original idea was we're gonna have Muppets playing the all the ghosts, obviously.
Christmas, past,
present, and future. Mm-hmm. But we're gonna have already established Muppets playing those roles. And then it was decided, we're just going to create new Muppets that are more along the lines of what is in the book.
They're supposed to look like, right?
And Robin the Frog was originally supposed to play the Ghost of Christmas Past because it's supposed to be like a child.
The Ghost of Christmas Past in this movie is terrifying.
Yeah, let's talk about her for a minute.
This is a new Muppet because we got
three big new Muppets, and they are the ghosts. Before we get into that, we should mention Statler and Waldorf, or are the Jacob and Robert Marley.
I like that we have Marleys. We have two because we had to have Statler and Waldorf.
Yes.
And they do a banging song.
Yes.
Where Marley and Marley. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
They do a great song. You have Fozzie Bear as Fozziewig.
Not Fezziwig.
Nope. Fozziewig. I hate Fozzie Bear, but I am Fozzie Bear, so...
You hate Fozzie Bear?
I don't hate him.
What
He's
kind
annoying.
Of a sick bastard?
I think
Waka,
my problem,
waka, waka, ma'am.
My problem with Fozzie Bear is that I recognize myself in him and I don't like it. That's my
He's
problem.
He's holding a mirror up to you.
Correct, and I don't appreciate it.
You are kind of waka waka.
I know I am. I know. I'm well aware. I wish I was a Miss Piggy, and I am a Fozzie Bear.
Now, one of my only like character complaints, and I was thinking about this as I was watching it, and of course it makes the most sense for Miss Piggy to be married to Kermit, to be Emily Cratchit.
Uh-huh.
But I feel like Miss Piggy, of all the Muppets, is probably the most underutilized in this movie.
She really is. I think
she doesn't get a lot
good.
To do. Like she's, and it's like a serious role. Like she's like playing a mother who's worried about her sick child. Like she doesn't get a lot of jokes, and you don't get the classic Miss Pigginess. Even though, I mean, it makes the most sense for her to be playing that. I feel like she's a little underserved in this movie.
I think she would have been better as Scrooge's former fiance. Wouldn't that have been good?
Oh my God, that would have been so funny.
Right?
Holy shit. You're right. Oh, I'm so mad they didn't do that now.
I know.
Oh.
I know.
And then we could get Michael Caine kissing Miss Piggy.
Like,
just a Muppet movie tradition. What I've always wanted. Humans fall in love with pigs.
I mean, she's a very sexy pig.
She is a sexy pig. I'll give her that.
If you're gonna fall in love with any pigs, like, it's right. Probably gonna be
she
her.
She does have the moves. She does do karate.
Plus, she rode that motorcycle through that window in Great Caper, and it was awesome.
She did. She did. Yeah.
I mean, she's not afraid.
No, she's a boss bitch. Miss Piggy is.
I think that would have been great if she had been the fiance. You could have gotten any old Muppet to play Emma Cratchit.
Now I'm just so mad at this. Yes, you could have. Mm-hmm. You could have.
Yeah. Yep. I know. It would have. I'm just thinking of that scene where they're like going and taking a walk, and through like the snow. And what if that had been Miss Piggy just bebopping along?
Oh,
Scrooge!
Oh, Ebenezer!
Oh, Ebenezer!
Oh, Ebby!
Oh, what are the other? Listen, Disney, we have an idea.
You got this new version coming out here in a couple days, right? Is it too late to reshoot all of Michael Caine's scenes with Miss Piggy?
Oh yeah, that's true. Yeah. Oh, it's not too late.
We also get a couple. We get some small Muppets, well-known Muppets in smaller roles. There's Muppets everywhere, mm-hmm. Obviously.
Oh, Muppets everywhere.
But
lousy with Muppets.
You get some Muppet cameos at Fozziwig's Big Christmas Party, which is, of course, during the Ghost of Christmas Past
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
sequence. You get Animal. You get Dr. Teeth and the Electric Mayhem featuring Animal
yes.
as the band, the party band.
Of course.
The Swedish chef is there preparing the food.
Obviously.
Urban Virgen.
Yeah.
Big Swedish chef fan.
Yeah, very big Swedish chef fan, yeah.
Yes.
Also,
you know what? I take it back what I said about April earlier with me thinking mm-hmm. that only the mice, because she's also...
The Swedish chef
gets her, yeah.
See, now, I feel like April would love Muppets. Everything about April's personality...
Oh, I don't think April does... No, I didn't say that. I'm talking about just laugh-out-loud laughs.
Yeah. Well, yeah.
No, I'm not saying she doesn't like them. Maybe she doesn't. She never expressed that to me.
And she never should.
Yeah, I'd keep
if
that,
she knows
I'd
what's
keep that one to yourself.
Keep that one in the vault. We also have Honeydew and Beaker.
That's Dr. Bunsen Honeydew to you.
Oh.
He didn't go to 8 years of Muppet Medical School, so you could call him Honeydew.
For you to call him Mr. Honeydew.
Mr. Honeydew. That's Dr. Bunsen Honeydew and Beaker. Yeah, they're the charity collectors. They're the...
Yeah.
The ones who, you know, Scrooge sends off and is mean to them at the beginning. And then.
Do you remember when we were growing up and Dad used to call me Beaker when I would complain about things and it would make me so mad?
Yeah, and then you'd get more Beaker-esque the madder
you
would get.
I know. Oh, God, it'd make me so mad.
You're kind of getting a little Beakery right now, I can tell. You want to.
Oh, God. Me. So mad.
so bad.
You know, like, least favorite Muppet, Sam the Eagle.
He's not a top tier Muppet.
He's playing the school headmaster, like, back when Scrooge is, like, really little. And he's very patriotic.
Yes.
And they have to keep reminding him, like, that he's in, like, a British...
That he's in England, not America.
Yeah.
So that's a pretty good little gag.
That is a good little gag. But yeah, just in general,
he's one of those
Sam
kind
Eagle.
Of, it's sort of one note, you know, like, you know, you can't do a whole lot with it. He's good for like a scene, but that's about it.
Yeah, pretty much. Not a lot of depth there. But still a really great cast. Great cast of Muppets.
Yeah, and then we get the ghost of Christmas
Present,
let's which
go
is
back to these ghosts.
Well, it's just kind of they're let's talk about the ghost, the new puppets. You want to talk about the Ghost of Christmas Past, which is some kind of
fucking,
Victorian child ghost.
She's some kind of doll that's been some soul has been trapped inside of her.
Sure. Oh yes.
And she's come to life. She's got this terrifying, like old China doll type face.
And it's all ethereal, like, and wispy.
She's very wispy. Wispy.
Yes.
It's unsettling. And she has, like, a tiny child's voice. And mm-hmm. I know that, like, the Ghost of Christmas Past is supposed to be, you know, a child. But she's just very unsettling. And I frankly would not want to fly above the city with her. I don't trust her.
Yeah. Well, I mean, these are ghosts. They are kind of supposed to be scary.
I get, but oh, but the Ghost of Christmas Present is not
Ghost of Christmas Present's not really that scary.
No.
Except for his massive size. He could sit on you.
He could, and he's kind of a dum-dum, so I don't think he'd even know he did it.
Yeah.
Like, he'd one of those, like, he'd sit on you, and he'd just be like, oh, no. He's a bit simple.
Uh-oh.
He loves, uh-oh. He does, he does love food, and for that, I gotta give him that. He does love food.
No, Ghost of Christmas Present seems like a pretty fun dude. Like he'd be good to hang out. He's very jolly.
He seems like a great
As long
man.
As you're chill, yeah. I think he'd be pretty chill.
Mm-hmm.
As long as you're appreciating your life and those around you and being charitable, yeah. Then I think, you know, he's gonna be real fun to hang out with.
Yeah, I think he just wants to like hang around, talk about good times, and eat like bunches of grapes.
And like turkey legs and stuff.
And giant turkey legs, yeah. Yes. And, you know, that all sounds great to me.
That sounds great.
Yeah. You got your classic Ghost of Christmas Future, which is just like a Grim Reaper situation.
Yes. Yeah. And, and I'm glad because, you know, that is kind of the most serious part of the story.
For sure.
Is, you know, Scrooge's final realizations and his redemption and all that. And, yeah, I'm glad they didn't really try to do, like, a big goofy thing.
Yeah, they did.
Because
didn't.
I think
they
it would have taken away.
It's...
Because he's playing it so seriously.
Yes.
I'm glad that was at least, like, they kind of, like, let the Ghost of Christmas Past just be and, like, not try to, like, make a bit out of it.
Right. And they could
like
very
it wouldn't
easily,
have worked.
But...
Yeah. But, yeah. And I agree with, like I said before, they were originally going to do, and I think I put it in the notes here, who was originally supposed to be the ghost. Okay, so the original Ghost of Christmas Past was either going to be when they were doing... Already established
known
Muppets.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Was either going to be Robin the Frog or Scooter. Was going to be... Because those are kids, I guess.
For Ghost of Christmas Past.
Past, yes.
Okay,
those
what
are
about
both kids.
Present?
Present was going to be Miss Piggy.
Okay.
I still think she would work better as the love of Michael Caine's life. I've got to go with you on that.
Yeah.
And then
what
the
about
ghost,
future?
Well, you're gonna hate this, and you're gonna be really glad that they didn't do this.
Is it Animal?
It's either Gonzo or Animal was supposed to be the ghost of Christmas Future, and that was obviously before they decided to make Gonzo Charles Dickens.
Gonzo is not dark enough. I mean, I don't know that any Muppet is dark enough. He's mysterious. We don't know where or what he is.
Yeah, but he's not so mysterious in a Grim Reaper kind of way. He's a mysterious in, like, you know, he's a wild animal from the jungle.
He's an enigma. He's an enigma.
Yes, he is.
No, I don't think any of the already established Muppets would have done a very good job at being the spooky one. Because, again, I think it would have felt like a bit, and I think it works better not. Like,
yes.
To keep the tone of that particular part of the movie serious, because that is like a serious thing in the story. Good call on them not doing already established Muppets.
Yeah, I do think that was a good call.
I don't think that would have worked as well.
No. Let's talk about the soundtrack. Amy, tell me about some of the songs. I know this is what you're wanting to talk about the most.
Well, they're great, first of all.
They're wonderful.
First of all, they slap. We've already talked about "Or Marley and Marley," which is, of course, when Statler and Waldorf come to Scrooge to tell them, you know, that there's going to be three ghosts. He will be visited by three ghosts, and then they're all ghostly, and they've got their chains, and they're singing the song, and just being very Statler and Waldorf-y.
Making fun of everything, you know.
Just making fun of everything.
Little comments.
And Michael Caine is playing it like he's going for a fucking Oscar, and it just works.
It does,
It just really, it really works. You've got that opening song, which is "One More Sleep Till Christmas."
That's not the opening song, I don't think. The opening...
Is it "Feels Like Christmas"?
Feels Like
the
Christmas,
opening song?
I think, is the
And
opening.
Then they do a reprise at the end.
And then there's the Scrooge song, which is at the beginning, which everyone, like the whole town, kind
of
sings about how
horrible
and miserly
like,
Scrooge is. And that song's
like,
just called Scrooge.
It's like Belle from Beauty and the Beast, but the opposite, because we're talking about how awful he is, not how wonderful he is. Yeah.
Yes. Basically.
It's just like going around the town,
And they're just dragging him.
I mean, sick burn after sick fucking burn.
Yeah, it's like You're a Mean One, Mr. Grinch, kind of. Where it's just like, write a long song about how this guy sucks ass.
Just relentless.
Yeah.
Relentless. And Scrooge doesn't give a fuck.
No.
Doesn't give a fuck.
No, he doesn't. No. It doesn't even register for him. More Sleep Until Christmas, though, is one of my favorite songs from
yeah, you're right. That is not the opening. It feels like Christmas is the opening and then the reprise at the end. Including Scrooge.
Yes.
Yeah, One More Sleep Till Christmas is great. You have that really, like, maudlin kind of song. The When Love Is Gone. But that's just on the soundtrack.
Well, so this right? there's a story about this song.
Okay.
When Love Is Gone, it was it's sung by Meredith Braun, who plays Belle in the past.
And you know, no shade to her.
No, she's fine.
She just should have been Miss Piggy.
It should have been Piggy.
Yep, should have been Piggy.
Yeah. And it's kind of like a it's you know, when basically Scrooge you know, she and Scrooge have been together and he's essentially choosing business over her. Choosing work and money over her.
Yeah.
So it's kind of like a sad, like, love song, kind of love coming to an end song. And it was cut by a Disney exec before the theatrical release. So it didn't even make it into the theatrical release. But they obviously filmed it. And the reasoning was that kids would be bored by it.
They're probably right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But it's not a long song. And I think that taking it out makes for a little bit of a jarring transition there in the story.
Uh-huh.
It kind of feels like there's something missing. So the song has been included on a couple of home video releases on, like...
Oh, okay.
Like full screen versions of so-and-so DVD that came out in this. Okay. But basically, it's all out of print. Anything that it was included on is out of print now.
Except.
So in 2018, Brian Henson...
Mm-hmm.
said that it was unlikely to be included in any future releases because they had lost the master and the film negative and all that. So it was, you know, not gone, but it probably wasn't going to be included. Except in 2020, they announced that that Disney archivist had found the
master
and film negative. So as we record this, we're at the very beginning of... Well, actually, we're at the very, very end of November.
Mm-hmm.
But December 11th, 2022, in just a few days, up on
the 30th anniversary?
On the 30th anniversary of the release of this movie, the full version, including the remastered When Love Is Gone sequence, is going to be available on Disney Plus. And
wow.
I'm imagining, because I was reading Brian Henson talking about it, and I imagine a 4K release is coming probably next year.
Well, now I'm going to have to rewatch it with this song.
Yeah, I'll probably watch it again.
I probably will rewatch it, to be honest, because it's just so damn...
Well, and I want to see it with that included in good quality. Yeah. And
also, I like to watch it on Christmas Eve now, so...
It's a good Christmas Eve movie.
Yeah.
I mean, Christmas Eve for me is usually It's a Wonderful Life, but...
Well, that's usually what I watch at night, yeah. But, like that's the last thing I watch. Except one year we watched It's a Wonderful Life and then the original Black Christmas, which made for a really weird double feature.
That sounds wonderful.
I mean, it was. I probably should have started with Black Christmas and ended with It's a Wonderful Life, though.
Yeah, probably.
Once I end get a little to the bit end on of a happier movie, note. I'm emotionally tapped out.
Yeah, understandable.
I know we're not talking about that movie, but I've seen it about 37 times, and I still fully cry. Not tear up, but full
you're talking about,
tears.
You're talking about Black Christmas, I assume.
Yes, of course.
Yes.
no, I fully cry at the end of It's a Wonderful Life every time. It does not matter. I know that's neither here nor there. Also, the ending of Black Christmas is fucking great. That movie's great.
Yes, it is.
It doesn't make me cry, but it does make me feel other things.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Here's a real sidebar. The tagline for that movie is, if this movie doesn't make your skin crawl, it's on too tight.
That's a great tagline.
It's a good one, isn't it?
It is good. Oh, here's us telling you to watch the original Black Christmas. Anyways, back to the Muppets.
It feels like Christmas.
Feels like Christmas. Yeah.
You know, wherever you find love, find it love, feels like Christmas.
I assume you're performing that as the Ghost of Christmas Present.
That is my Ghost of Christmas Present voice.
You had a jovial, jolly,
yes.
Very, very jovial, very jolly.
Very similar to my Santa voice.
It's a Père Noël, if you will. It's like a very... Papa Noël. It's a Papa Noël. God, can't wait to watch the Santa Claus. Basically, this is a perfect movie, and I have no notes. except for that Miss Piggy would have been better used. Should have been as Ebenezer's love interest, Belle. That is my only note. I otherwise have no qualms with this movie. I mean, we tend to pick perfect movies to induct. It is the Hall of Fame. It is the Cool Kids Club, yes. Movie Club Hall of Fame. I mean, you know.
The assumption going in is we love these movies.
Correct.
So Disney, it came out on December 11th, 1992, like I said, and Disney had big expectations for the movie. They were actually, this was their second biggest as far as like marketing and promotion. Mm-hmm. It was their biggest of the holiday season and their second biggest of the entire year, because a month earlier was when Aladdin came out.
Arabian Nights.
So,
which we've already inducted.
So, the Muppet Christmas Carol didn't have a very large impact on release. It kind of was, it debuted at like number 6.
It kind of
picked up a little bit, and you know, it like earned, it was like a modest box office success. Like, it didn't lose money or anything. It made money, but not a ton.
But Justin, what else came out at Christmas that year?
Well, we had Aladdin, of course, like I said, which was another Disney production. So
which came out in like November. That was like a Thanksgiving movie. Yeah, or something. It was still in theaters.
It was still huge. Plus, you had Home Alone 2, Lost in New York.
Yeah. Yep. Yeah.
So
there's why.
That'll do it.
That'll do it. That'll knock them Muppets down. And I love Home Alone 2, Lost in New York, but it doesn't hold a candle as far as coziness and comfort to a Muppet Christmas Carol. I'm just going to say it.
No, I agree. And no shade at Home Alone 2.
No, because it's a great movie.
Except it does have Donald Trump in it.
Does the Tim Curry balance out the small bit of Donald Trump?
Yes, I'd say that there's such a minuscule amount of Donald Trump that mm-hmm. the Tim Curry definitely, and there's quite a bit of Tim Curry.
Pizza.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's...
It doesn't make it unwatchable, certainly.
No. Plus, it's always just fun to flip my TV off aggressively.
Yes.
Every now and then.
So done that a lot the last couple of years.
Yeah, a lot. Right. More than's good for me.
Yeah.
But not during A Christmas Carol with the Muppets.
No, there's no reason Never. For me to.
No, there's no
to
reason.
Flip this movie
There's
off.
No anger. It's just all good feels.
It feels like Christmas.
I do want to just shout out.
It is the season of the heart. Sorry.
It's such a good song. I'm going to add that to like a Christmas playlist. It's great. I do want to just give a shout out to one of our close friends who this is like one of their favorite movies of all time. Mm. And they are actually the one who told me that they have watched it every Christmas Eve. Like, that's their Christmas Eve tradition. And that is our beautiful, lovely friend, Katie, who I know is a big fan of the show and listening. So shout out to Katie. This is one of her favorite movies ever. And she watches it every Christmas Eve. And that has gotten me to watch it every Christmas Eve.
Yeah.
So yeah, I usually watch that earlier in the day, and then I will watch It's a Wonderful Life. That's like usually the last thing that I do. And then I go to bed thinking about my friends and my life choices. And it's really sad. It's really sad.
Yeah. And Katie's husband, Harold, our good friend, is the one who introduced me to A Muppet Family Christmas, which is another...
That is true. They are big Muppet fans as well.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
Big Muppet crew we got going on.
We do have a big Muppet crew, and I love it. Before we induct this movie into the Cool Kids Club Movie Club Hall of Fame. We gotta start shortening titles of things, but I think it's funnier when they're ridiculously long. Mm-hmm. Is there anything else we want to talk about with this movie, or do we want to just, you know?
I think I've said it all. I think it's a wonderful movie. Yeah. It's my favorite adaptation of A Christmas Carol. There are a lot of great adaptations of A Christmas Carol.
Mm-hmm.
It's become one of my favorite Christmas movies. Not one that I maybe fully appreciated until I was an adult, even. But it's a staple in our house nowadays. Definitely. I think it's one of my favorite Muppet movies. It's a top tier Muppet movie.
Ooh, now you have to tell me what others are.
Well, I mean, you know, it's probably this one, and I love Great Muppet Caper. Muppet Caper. Yeah,
The Great Muppet Caper is great.
The original Muppet movie, of course, is really good as well.
Really good. My favorite part about that movie is Kermit riding a bicycle.
Yes,
which is just a sight to behold.
Yes.
And especially for like 78 or whatever.
And Fozzie Bear up doing comedy on stage, and you see his entire body, and it's weird looking.
It's so weird. Because you never see their feet. It's very strange. That's a good one too. But this one just has that charm, and it's Christmassy. It has that
Christmas magic.
It does, it really does. It feels like Christmas.
It feels like Christmas.
All right, Justin. Well, do you want to do the honors?
Yeah, I by the power vested in me by
yourself,
by myself,
and me, I guess.
Yeah, don't invest in me. I hereby induct the Muppet Christmas Carol into the Cool Kids Movie Club Hall of Fame.
Well, this has been a lovely episode talking all about Muppets. Stay tuned for more Muppet content in the new year. I'm just saying it
right
now.
More Muppet content in the new year and more Yule Kids Club content this month.
That's true. We have yet another Yule Kids Club episode coming up in 2 weeks, just in time for Christmas.
And we might have.
Are we telling people what it is?
Well, they can probably figure out what it is if they're paying attention to the kind of rotation we're getting into. We're doing the volume 2 of the Christmas tape, and then we may have a little bonus episode coming up at the very end of the year. That
will we
perhaps? So, so yeah, we may have that coming up, and we're doing the Christmas tape, and a couple other short form Christmas goodies. There's a lot of Christmas specials to choose
from. There's a lot of that, so we'll be good for several years on that front. we'll be doing good. We hope that you enjoyed this episode talking about A Muppet Christmas Carol. Let's go ahead and talk about our socials. You can find us on Instagram and Twitter at Cool Kids Club Pod. We are most active on Instagram. Justin runs our Instagram account and it does a wonderful job. And so a lot of the interactions, most of the interactions you're getting on there are with Justin. Mostly because I have somehow gotten myself logged out of that account and I need to get back into it. I figured out the other day because I wanted to go post something and I was like, I am somehow not logged into that. But anyway, go check us out on there. We will be doing favorite Muppet polls as the episode comes out, as the weekend progresses. So go on there and choose your favorite Muppet. Choose your fighter. If you want to follow us personally on the interwebs, you can follow me at AmyReadsTN on Instagram. Justin, where can the good people find you on Instagram?
They can find me at LousyWithGhosts. Of course, shout out Brian Hey Guys Wakefield for our wonderful Christmas version, our Yule Kids Club theme.
Yes, and all of our bangers.
All of the versions of our theme song. All come from the wonderful brain of Brian. Also, check out Blue Bard Cage if you want to hear me talk about wrestling. I talk about wrestling sometimes with those dudes over there. So find it wherever you found this. I also wanted Before we go, you and I made a little appearance on another podcast, a new podcast.
We sure did. So we sure did.
If you're not following at Retroplex _ on Instagram, go follow her. She's a friend of ours, and she has a new podcast called Treatland.
Yes.
Where she takes submissions about people waxing nostalgic, basically, about different kinds of food or different, you know, sort of treats,
if you will.
Treats, if you will.
Yeah. Treats. Treats.
So, yeah, you and I contributed a segment to the second episode about school lunches. Mm-hmm. So
we sure did.
Go check out all the episodes of the Treatland podcast. And I think we will probably be appearing on some future episodes as well.
I imagine we will.
So, yeah, check out Treatland.
Thank you guys so much for listening. Again, we will be back with another Yule Kids Club episode this month. But in the meantime, we hope that you all stay jolly. And most importantly, stay Yule. Should we tell them can you stay Yule?
Stay Yule.
Can one even be Yule?
How can one be Yule?
How can one? I guess just go ahead and stay cool, and then we'll figure out the rest later.
Yeah, we're going to circle back on that. I'll do some research.
Okay.
It's in the singing of a street corner choir. It's going home and getting warm by the fire. It's true wherever you find love, it feels like Christmas.
A cup of kindness that we share with another. A sweet reunion with a friend or a brother.
In all the places you find love, it feels like Christmas.
It is the season of the heart, a special time of caring. The ways of love make clear.
It is the season of the spirit, the message every year.